Me and you, both of us, tonight, this morning, can receive a revelation from the Lord. I don't know if you ever thought about that. You get up in the morning and, well, it could be a day like any day, but today could be the day that you receive a revelation from God. Now, John, when he was on the Isle of Patmos, received a revelation. Why can't you receive a revelation, or me receive a revelation? I need it, and you need it, because we need something new that really motivates us to follow the Lord today. So let's really pray. Father, we pray that you will reveal something to us from your word this morning that will change our lives and will motivate us to know what's coming in the future and to really live for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. That's my prayer for me. I need it as much as you do. And the scripture we've got covering it this morning is, do not conform any longer to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing and perfect will. Don't be conformed to the world, but be transformed. I want to ask you a question. I looked up the word transformed in Greek, and what do you think it means? What do you think the Greek word is for transformed? I found it interesting. I hadn't really thought about it before, but I looked up the word transformed, and it's the word metamorphosis. Now, we know that as a biological term, and we're going to have a picture up here now of metamorphosis, because God wants to transform us. And we all know the sort of picture here of the egg, which you can start any way you like, really, can't you? You can start with the egg, and then it becomes a larva, a caterpillar that eats things up and has no reproduction organs, apparently. And then it goes into a pupa, and something happens in the pupa to totally transform it. Now, what we just read is, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So what's going to transform us? It's our mind being renewed. And how's our mind going to be renewed? By reading God's word, principally. And sometimes when we're, especially if you're a speaker, you're guilty of this very often, that you think, well, you know it and you're going to speak what you know. But actually, I need to learn something new today so that I can be transformed. In the Old Testament, I've spoken many times about the fact that they were always asked to look for new manna every day. And manna signifies the word of God. We need to eat the new manna. It's not yesterday's thoughts, not something that motivated me yesterday, because yesterday's thoughts are, well, in the Old Testament it said they've gone smelly. They were okay yesterday. They were perfectly okay, good food, but yesterday, as we know with bread, it goes mouldy. Now, yesterday's bread can be mouldy. We need fresh bread for today, and that's the word of God. We need something fresh for today, and we can be transformed this morning. I can be transformed as I'm listening and meditating to God's word. I'll leave that image up for a bit because I think it's important for us to realize how much transformation God wants to do. When I became a Christian, and of course the first transformation is that we give our lives to Jesus, isn't it? You get into this by, you become, as it were, the seed or the egg, or is when we give our lives to the Lord. And we say, Lord, just take it. Let's use my life. I just want to forget my old life and take on the new life. And that's the beginning of the transformation in me and in you. But it doesn't stop there. It says we are changed and transformed, metamorphosized from one degree of glory to another. And I want that today. I don't want to be like I was yesterday, however good it was. And it wasn't very good anyway, but you know what you're like, don't you? I know what I'm like. I just want to be better today than I was yesterday. And it's not really a question of building on yesterday. It's a question of being transformed, actually going into the pupa. How are we going to, what's the going into the pupa going to be? For me, it's going into the Word of God in the beginning of the day and just listening and meditating and thinking. Actually, I usually just put the Bible on and do whatever I'm doing and have it in the background. You do whatever works for you, but the main thing is that the Word of God is washing. It talks about in the Bible being washed by the Word of God. And that's what I want. So I want got my brain to be washed. You probably have heard, well, J. John said, when he came back as a Christian and full of the Holy Spirit, his mum said, "You've been brainwashed." His mother was a Jew. "You've been brainwashed." And he said, "Mum, if you knew how dirty my brain was before, you'd be really pleased I've been brainwashed." The enemy is so subtle and so horrible that he will use anything to stop you washing your brain with God's word. But I need it. I need to be transformed. I don't want anything that was yesterday. I want something new today. So I don't know if you're the same as me on that. I need to be motivated. And God's word's motivating. God's word's extremely creative. You know, he created the world by speaking, didn't he? He said, "And let there be light," and there was light. And I'm sure he called different things into being, different animals specifically. I don't know how God creates, but anyway, we certainly do know it's through the word at the beginning. So God can create something new in my mind and new in your mind. He can transform you. Now, if you look at the butterfly and the larva, can you see any similarity? Not really. Well, okay, maybe a little. But really, the larva, it's just an eating machine, apparently. It just eats. That's what it gets up in the morning, if it gets up. And it just eats. Maybe it eats through the night as well. And it just eats all the time. Were you like that? You know, before I was a Christian, I just wanted to give, take. You know, my teeth went bad. I ate so much. When I was a child, I used to have my pocket money and go and buy Mars bars and Pear Drops. So do you remember Pear Drops? And and my teeth went bad as a result. But the results of just living for yourself is that you go bad. Analogy of your teeth going, you know, you're just eating, you're just taking, taking what you can out of life. That's the caterpillar. That's what I was like anyway. You probably a lot better than I was. But you know, there's nothing compared. You can't see any similarity. Inside that pupa, it just gets completely, it's incredible. Apparently, it goes into a little goo, a gooey liquid. And it must have all the DNA and things in there. But the gooey liquid, what's it going to do? And it's a total, absolute transformation, metamorphosis. A total transformation. And nothing compared to what it was before. That's what God wants to do in me. I know. And what I want to encourage you this morning, and me too, don't hold on to anything of the past. It was no good. I know you studied psychology and philosophy and all that stuff. And I'm not saying we throw all that away, but just don't let it hinder you. Because sometimes we filter our thoughts through the past instead of reading God's word and trusting. I suppose a lot of problem is trusting God's word. Do you really trust the word of God? And I need to really ask the question to myself. I need to trust God's word so that I know that all I need is God's word. I don't need anything more than God's word. Of course, it might be useful to have, you know, some understanding of psychology. I'm talking about how the mind is transformed, by the way, here, because obviously science is important to learn things, you know, which help us. But I'm talking about the mind transformation now. I believe we need to trust God for our mind transformation. So what does that mean? For me and for you, it means immersing myself in God's word all the time, as much as I can. Well, how can you keep that alive? Because sometimes we do that. You hear that now and you think, oh, I've got to do that. And it's not a question of got to. We've got to, I was going to use the word got to. Try and generate in us a desire to read God's word. So how do we do that? Well, ask the Lord, because we're all different. You're different from me. We're all extremely different of the way we do things. So I'm just going to say what works for me. And then you can ask the Lord, Lord, how can I develop a real love for your word that will go in all the time and get me into that pupa every day and just kind of like be with you? And in the pupa, you kind of like, I don't care about the old. I want to be transformed. I want to become a butterfly. I want to fly around. I want to be productive, because the butterfly has reproductive organs. In fact, I think that's what it does all day. It just flies around looking for a mate, by the sound of it. Well, it eats nectar to keep alive, doesn't it? So it pollinates flowers. I'm sure, I'm belittling what butterflies do. I'm sure they do millions of things, but we know that one of the important things they do is they reproduce, and they produce eggs, so that the whole thing can start again. One of our tasks as Christians, and perhaps the main task when we become butterflies, is to reproduce. Let's see more and more people coming into the kingdom. But you can't reproduce if you're not transformed in the first place. The caterpillar's not got any reproductive organs. If you stay like that, you'll just be self-centered all day long and doing what your own thing and doing what pleases you and eating, oh, that's nice, I'm going to eat that. You know, that's what we'll do if we're staying as a caterpillar. We need to get into the pupa and say, God, transform me. Cry out to the Lord. It's psalmist. Cry out. God, change me. Create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within me. And we know that because of Jesus' death on the cross, we can be transformed from death to life. Because Jesus, in a way, is like a metamorphosis, isn't it? He goes onto the cross. He dies. He goes into the tomb, into the pupa. He comes out 3 days later, resurrected. And we can do that every day, really. If you notice any bit of the caterpillar in you still, well, get him into the pupa quickly. Get him in there. Say, no more caterpillar. Don't attempt, I mustn't attempt, to be like I used to be, or to live on the thoughts I used to live on. You know, they'll come back to me if they're going to be useful. Some things, you know, will come back. In fact, when I became a Christian, I gave up music, more or less. Now, you probably know, if you know me, that I do a lot of music now. I play the piano a lot and so on. But I gave it up because it was just, I don't know, it just stunk of caterpillar. It just didn't really do for me anything. I like singing choruses. I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about me producing music. I had to study it. I was doing a degree, so I had not a choice in that respect. But I lost total interest in it because I just wanted to go for God. And that's what happens when you're born again. This happened to me. Again, we are all different, and if you've grown up in a Christian home, it may not have had that sudden transformation, but ask God for a sudden transformation today, I would recommend. I want transformation today. So we can... I just want to show you one of the things that I do, and I do it daily, which is to get my mind on the scriptures. And what we're going to do, actually, we're going to go through... we're going to go through Revelation, and bit by bit, you might wonder what this has got to do with Revelation, but Revelation is the word to reveal, to show, to demonstrate. The word, they actually use the word apocalypse if you're in Spanish for Revelation, but it's the word apocalypse is actually nowadays taken on a different meaning of catastrophe, but actually it wasn't. It should be the word apocalypse. It should be revelation. It should be something that's revealed to you about the future. Something's going to happen. In fact, that says at the beginning of Revelation. We're going to go from verse 9 to 20. And one of the things I do is listen to the Bible with this chap.
I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned round to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, and of the seven golden lampstands, is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches."
It's David Suchet, or Poirot, for those who used to watch Poirot. He was Poirot for me. I didn't realise he became a Christian at about the age of 50 when he found a Bible in, or part of it was he finding a Bible in a hotel room. There's a very good interview of David Suchet by Jay John. I recommend Facing the Canon, David Suchet. And he talks all about how he became a Christian. But Norita and I always used to like Poirot, the detective, Agatha Christie. And it was him who played the most famous Poirot. And he did all of them, every single Poirot, I think. And he's become a Christian, and he said to himself, "I'm going to read the whole Bible before I retire, and read the whole Bible, and the whole Bible from beginning to end." You can download on your phone, or you can just watch it on YouTube. You just put Revelation chapter 1, David Suchet, and it will come up, and all the rest of Revelation will come up too. But there he is. Thank you. So David Suchet is obviously an actor, but dedicated now to really using his talent of reading. What talent have you got? What talent have I got? I certainly can't read like that, so I thought you'd be better hearing him than me. And we've all got something that we can give. So let's go into the pupa, and I'm using the analogy here of just getting alone with God, really, and listening. I just want to talk about listening to the Word of God a bit, because this is my own experience again. I listen to God's word as much as I can during the day. So it's beginning, and then when I'm having a bath, I told you recently, I had a bath and put Revelation on. I put David Suchet on from right all through Revelation. And I've done that four times now. And I just find it, and when you study the Bible, you can know the enemy is terrible. The enemy is awful. You know, you have an enemy and I have an enemy, and he will try to destroy whatever God wants to do. So you're reading the Bible. First of all, the enemy will say, "Oh, that's not the way to do it." And then he'll say, "Oh, you're not really doing it very deeply." And then he'll say, "This is the enemy, by the way," because God's never like that. He's saying, "Great, my son's reading the Bible. He doesn't really care how you do it." Well, you know what I mean. He just really pleased that you're reading the Bible, listening to the Bible. And don't think you've got to concentrate like mad, or you've got to do this, or, you know, just read it. And if you read it and you're not concentrating a lot, it'll still go in. I can tell you, I like putting it on when I'm going to sleep as well. I did that the other day, put Revelation on. You do that, don't you, Lawrence? When you're going to sleep, put Revelation on. I say Revelation because I've decided I'm studying Revelation. It's something I've never done, and I've always avoided Revelation because I've always thought it was a book that people were in disputes about. Somebody thought that about it, and somebody's a premillennialist, and there's a postmillennialist. Blow me down. This is the Revelation. I'm just going to listen to it. And forget about all the millennialism. I just want to listen. I don't want to come out and say to you, it's post-millennium, it's pre-millennium, it's this millennium, it's that and the other. I just want to read it and ask the Lord to speak to me through it. Something new. Not to give what people thought about it years ago. It's fresh. God's word is fresh. Fresh bread. It smells great, fresh bread, doesn't it? When God's word is fresh, it's fresh. I'm going to leave it there because it's run out of time. I just realized my watch did a vibration and told me to run out of time. But I hope that's been helpful to start with. And let's just go to the main theme again. You used to be a caterpillar. I used to be a caterpillar. I went into a pupa. That was when I said, "Jesus, I give my life to you." And I came out thinking, "Who am I? What's this thing flying around? I'm totally different. So I want to encourage you, don't be frightened about being totally different from what you used to be. I'm not saying that your philosophies and psychologies and works of wearing on the brain are totally useless, though in some cases they are. I'm just saying God's word is totally all you need. Totally. I really believe that. So you don't need anything else except for God's word. And it will transform, it will create, as it did in the beginning, and there was light. It will create in your heart. It'll do everything that you need to make you transform from glory to glory, to make you metamorphosize. Did you ever think you're going to metamorphosize? That you're going to be no resemblance to what you used to be? If I look back at my life before I became a Christian, I actually am pretty much no resemblance to what I used to be. But I want to be even more no resemblance to what I used to be, because I recognize there's a way to go for me. Lord, I just pray that you'll transform us all. Lord, from glory to glory, from Lord, stop us from wanting to cling on to what we used to be. And Lord, just have the faith in your word to be transformed, be totally different from what we used to be, and be very productive and reproductive, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.